you know, as you start to look at manned unmanned teaming in some of the robotic areas, you know, 5G has got a tremendous amount of opportunity to allow for that type of connectivity. We even look at one of the areas we haven't talked about is the aerial layer, and we start to thicken the network, not just in the terrestrial, not just space, but also in the air. And as General Ray mentioned too, within space, there's a lot of opportunity there. However, at the same token, you know, 5G has got, you know, when it comes, has got some sensitivities when it comes to foliage, blockage and other activities. So I think once again, that is just another area where, you know, it's going to be another layer of connectivity that we can afford and provide. I think it's going to have a lot of contributions, as well as I know within the department, we're starting to look at, a rollout in various tranches, starting at, even at our installations and then moving down to our tactical environment. But as you start to look at some of the future demands for information, you know, when you get into future battle space, 5G is going to have a tremendous opportunity and the ability to transport some of the information at a much quicker pace and at a much higher throughput.
And dispersing the formation is going to be critical in the future. And I mean, you can watch the ongoing operations. We'll use that as an example. Dispersion of our forces will be important. And I think 5G plays a big role in that going forward, both terrestrial and at the space layer, I think is going to be key across the board.
And we have a follow-up question from our audience. This person asks, what types of communication systems will be used in JADC2? Will they include 5G, 6G, cognitive radio, et cetera? And what will be the primary types of communication systems that will serve as that JADC2 backbone?
So I think the answer is yes. I think it's all the above. We really are looking toward a future that's got, you know, multi-layer, multi-function, multi-band capability. And I think one of the things that we're trying to embrace, and we'll never be able to forecast, you know, all these future opportunities, but one of the areas that General Ray and I spend a fair amount of time is, you know, what is the open systems architecture? And this is where we look to industry to help, you know, how can we have not just an open architecture, but a common open systems architecture. In fact, one of the initiatives that we've been working closely with Air Force and the Navy is on the SOSA consortium. It's an open systems architecture consortium for a lot of transport initiatives. And this is where we get to something as simple as an open chassis that's got various card slots. I can slide in a card for position, navigation, timing. I can slide in a card for electronic warfare or basic communications, be it space, be it ground. And all of this is defined not through mil specs, but through joint agreed to standards between both government and through industry. And that way we can have a, you know, a modular and open system. And that really affords us the opportunity, not just to keep pace with technology and all some of the things that you mentioned, but the adversary is evolving rapidly too as well. And so we have to continue both from a technology perspective and keeping pace with the threat. But I really think our investments and our time to have a framework of a common open systems architecture, I think it holds true, not only in some of the traditional transport items that you mentioned, but I think also in the data fabric. We're similarly trying to lay out a data fabric that has a open systems architecture of a set of Lego building blocks. And then we can continue to evolve and not be beholden to a singular monolithic capability, but something that can evolve and keep pace with technology and threat and evolve much more at a much quicker pace than it has in the past.
Yeah, so coming out of Project Convergence 21, one of our premier exercise experimentation events that we hold, it really focuses on how do we get after JADC2. And coming out of that, one of the key things we focused on was the data fabric. So that's one of the bookends that I believe is important in order to achieve sensitive shooter. The other bookend that I believe is important for JADC2 is getting the mission partner environment correct. If we get those two correct across the board, I think those are the bookends that is going to make JADC2 realized across the board. So PC22 is going to focus more on data sharing. It's going to focus on operational synchronization, and then some integration with our joint and coalition partners across across the board, looking at that mission partner environment and how we share information across the board, sensitive shooter data as well.